seated as we pray together the opening prayer found in your bulletin. Let us pray. Mighty One of Israel, we follow generations of fellow believers along well-traveled places as we love to claim you as our God and to be known as your people. We remember deeds of the saints who went before us, loving to count ourselves in their mighty company. Forgive our hesitancy to build our own monuments to your importance in our lives. Forgive our reluctance to put on our own armor of faith as we face the powers of sin and death in our own lives. In the powerful name of our Victor, Jesus Christ. Amen. Welcome again to St. John's. We are glad that you are here to worship today. If you haven't done so, please record your presence in the friendship pads. They're the booklets that are located near the center aisle, and pass them down to those around you. And we invite you to come out tonight to the baseball field at USC Aiken and cheer on Dr. Tim, aka Coach Mac, and several of our church members, including Douglas, our summer intern. They will be playing in Coach T's fantasy baseball game, and the baseball game starts at 5 o'clock, and details are on the cover of your bulletin. So come out and support this charity and support our players and coach. We also have welcomed many new members this month, and Midge is going to come and introduce our new members for today at this service.
Good morning, everyone. This is a place everybody seems to want to be. I'm proud to tell you that because of your warmth and the way that you extend your hospitality in God's house, that we have welcomed a total of 23 new members this month. Isn't that a number that we can all be proud of? 23. This morning at this precise service, we have a young family joining, so I would invite Lindsay and Stuart Griswold to come forward with their darling 2.5-year-old son, Fielding Matthew, also known as Field. He might be a little afraid of Dr. Tim, I'm not quite sure. Let me come forward so everyone can see you. And speaking of everyone seeing them, this will be a special day in the life of Fielding. Because he will be baptized after the worship service this morning. And then I ask you all, as many as you can, to join us at the fountain for lemonade and cookies for our monthly new member and everybody else kind of reception. And a lot of you are sort of new, and it's a good way to get to know people. Dr. Tim, let me tell you a little bit about Lindsay and Stuart. Lindsay teaches accounting at USC Aiken, and Stuart is at SunTrust Bank. Today, Margaret, Lindsay's aunt, is visiting and watching what's going on, and Tweety, yes, that's really her name, Stuart's mom is here to see what's going on, so we welcome them to be in our congregation. I wanted to let you know that their family will be expanding on Christmas Day. There will be another member of the Griswold family. So Field is enrolled in our seed program, and we welcome them today, St. John's.
I'd like for you to turn to page 38. Stuart and Lindsay, the only question that I need to ask you, but it's an important question. It's a question that all new members are asked. Will you uphold this congregation by your prayers, your presence, your witness, your gifts, and your service? And if so, say, I will.
I will.
Now, brothers and sisters, as members of this congregation, will you faithfully, it's number 15, as members together of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service? Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. This congregation, and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in its ministries of church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. We welcome you. Thank you so much. You may be seated, and we'll see you after the service. God bless you.
Please rise as we affirm our faith by reciting the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Let's join together in prayer. Oh Lord, we use many shields to protect ourselves. We put up walls to keep out hurt and danger. We pray for your safety. We pray, oh Lord, for your blessing upon those in our congregation who are sick and who are hurting. We pray your deliverance in this battle against the spiritual forces of darkness. We try on our own to do what we can. We build safer homes. We want safer cars, and we do everything imaginable, from the things that we eat to the exercise that we get, in order to protect ourselves. But Lord, we need your protection, for we know, as your word has said, that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the evil powers of this world. So, Lord, we need you. We need to trust you. We need to let you to be the one who protects us. We need to put on your armor, not our own. Only you can keep us from sin and help us flee temptation and resist Satan. So we let go of our man-made shields, and we put on your truth and your righteousness. We confess that sometimes we put on airs more than we put on the armor of God, and we're guilty of girding ourselves with untruths or half-truths or fake news rather than the truth. Lord, we believe in the truth, and we believe that you have said that you are the way and the truth and the life, and so we depend upon you. So help us be protected against arrogance or self-reliance, against anything that we would use instead of your righteousness, your gift of faith, and your gift of salvation. Help us, Lord, to follow in your footsteps with paths of peace and justice. Lord, help us not to use your word to attack one another, but to use it as a gospel of peace. So, Lord, we come to you this day confessing our sins, praying for those who need help and guidance. We pray that you will give us the gift of wisdom and strength so that we can change our ways, so that we can live as faithful ambassadors of your good news. This is our prayer that we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. And we pray now the prayer that you taught your disciples praying. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Before I invite the ushers to come forward, I do want to welcome you once again to this service, and I do hope that you'll find the time this afternoon. We will play ball at 5:06 this afternoon. We'll have batting practice before that and a chance for the players from St. John's and the players from Cedar Creek Church to gather together with Coach T as we support the charity of Carly's Rays of Hope. She was a young person in the Aiken midst who died of brain cancer, and we want to support this opportunity to eradicate brain cancer. There's been exciting news out of Duke University and other places in recent days that let us know that there is hope, but we want to help push that over the top so we can make sure that there are more young people and more young adults and adults who are protected from this dread disease. So I hope to see you this afternoon. I will be in a different uniform. And now let us give to God as God has given to us as we invite our ushers to come forward for our morning tithes and offerings.
now as the children follow the crucifer out to Children's Chapel, I invite you to remain standing as we sing our hymn of preparation, hymn number 514, Stand Up for Jesus.
You may be seated. Our scripture lesson this morning is found in Paul's letter to the Ephesian church, Ephesians chapter 6, beginning at verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you've done everything, to stand. Stand firm, then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. There was a man driving down the wrong way on an interstate one day, a little bit addled in his actions and his demeanor and what he had been doing. He was driving down the wrong way and he was pulled over by a policeman who asked him, "Didn't you see the arrows?" And in his confused state, he said, "Man, I didn't even see the arrows and I sure didn't see the Indians." Not exactly the kind of battle that Paul talks about in this passage of Scripture. But all of us deal with different kinds of battle, and some of us have been down the wrong side of an interstate and driven the wrong way. But there is a real war going on that Paul does talk about, and we cannot be deserters. We cannot be like Switzerland and declare our neutrality in this ongoing, everlasting battle between good and evil. We may not hear whizzing bullets pass by our heads or see bombs exploding over us, but nevertheless, it is a real war that we can't straddle the fence about and that we can't go AWOL away without leave about. We've got to take a position between good and evil so that good might win. When we give our hearts to Jesus, we don't give our hearts to Jesus for a frolic, we give our hearts to Jesus because it's a fight. It's a fight that God wants us to win, and he wants to equip us to win. Some of us, however, we think that evil is imaginary, at least a figment of our minds or our imagination. We don't really believe for certain that there is a personal evil, but the Bible describes that there is. In this passage of Scripture, if it leaves you any doubt, it says that we are aware of the devil's schemes. Satan's schemes, the accuser. As I think about Paul, he says, "I fought the good fight." In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7, he says, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished. I have finished." So it's a very real battle that we fight. I heard of a prize fighter that reminds me of folks who don't believe there's a real devil. I heard about a prize fighter who was getting beaten in every round of the match that he was fighting. And in between the rounds, he would go to his stool over in the corner, and his trainer would pour water on him and help fix his wounds and put ice on his swollen eyes. He was being beaten over and over mercilessly. But in between the rounds, the trainer would say, "You go get him, Tiger. He hasn't laid a hand on you." And he'd go out there, and he'd get beaten a little bit more, and he'd come back to the stool, and the trainer would say, "Go get him, Tiger. He hasn't laid a hand on you." And that happened round after round. "Go get him, Tiger. He hasn't laid a hand on you." And then finally, just before the last round was to take place, the trainer said, "Go get him, Tiger. He hasn't laid a hand on you." And the fighter said, "Well, you better then keep an eye on the referee, because somebody's beating the heck out of me." Whether you believe in a real devil or not, I know that most of us are quite aware that somebody's beating the heck out of us. And we don't know where it's coming from, but we know that it's true. And the Bible passage that I read earlier says that this unseen enemy that's been whipping us in every round and on every turn, his name is Satan. So we need to be aware that we are in a spiritual warfare against Satan and his minions, principalities and powers of this dark world. And so Paul says for us to hang in there and to put on God's whole armor. Now, first of all, I'm glad that he says put on God's armor, because my armor is not that good. And your armor's not that good. But God's armor takes care of us and protects us in ways that our own armor could never do so. And he says, put on the whole armor of God. Not just bits and pieces, but put on the whole armor of God. And because God is who God is, God wins this battle when we put on the whole armor. 1 John chapter 4, verse 4 says, greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. Do we believe that? Do we act like we believe that? Or do we tuck tail and run because evil is after us and chasing us? Not the hound of heaven, but the hound of the other place. But greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. So with God's strength, with God's armor, his whole armor, we can face Satan and we can win this battle. We can win this battle because our confidence is in God, because God is stronger than Satan. Only God is omnipotent, all-powerful. Only God is omniscient, knows all things. Only God is omnipresent in every place. Psalm 139 reminds us that there is no place that we can flee from God's power and God's presence. Satan is not that powerful. Sometimes we make out that the devil is a lot stronger than he really is, but he's not. Which reminds me of the story that took place right after Gulf War I in the Persian Gulf. As General Norman Schwarzkopf, Stormin' Norman was asked just several days after the war ended, which didn't last that long anyway, he was asked, how was it that he was able to defeat such a wonderful military leader like Saddam Hussein? And Norman Schwarzkopf, with tongue in cheek as he answered, said these words, Saddam is neither a strategist nor schooled in the operational art of planning and execution. He is not a tactician, nor is he a general. He's not even a soldier. Besides all that, he's a great military leader. Sometimes we make the devil out to be a great military leader, but compared to God, the devil is nothing. So we put on the whole armor of God. Paul knew about the whole armor of God because Paul was in the last days of his life. He had been in prison in Rome when he wrote this letter to the Ephesians. As I said a few moments ago when I read the scripture, it said that he was an ambassador in chains. He had been chained to the left hand of a Roman soldier for four-hour shifts, 24 hours a day. He knew about a Roman soldier's armor because he saw it every time a Roman soldier held him under house arrest. And so Paul says, knowing this armor, that we should fight. Knowing how powerful and effective this armor is, he says, put on the whole armor of God. Interestingly, Paul never says, none of the New Testament writers say that we should flee Satan. It says over and over again that we should flee temptation, but it never says we should flee Satan. We don't have to flee Satan. We are to resist him, it says over and over again in the Bible, but we are to flee temptation. But with Satan, we are to face him down. We are given a call to arms in this passage of Scripture. We shouldn't tuck tail and run in the opposite direction. We should face Satan down because greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. Only God is omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent. Now, you might notice about this armor, if I turn around, that all of this armor protects my front. None of it protects my back. It only protects my front. So if I run from Satan, if I think Satan is so powerful and great that I'm afraid of him and I don't trust in God's power as being more mighty, if I tuck tail and run in the opposite direction, that's when I'm most vulnerable. And so what I need to do is I need to face Satan and know that this armor is meant for fighting, not for running. It reminds me of the story of the private. The private who was on the front line and he was afraid. The war, the battle, and everything was going poorly. And so he was overwhelmed with cowardice and fear and trepidation. So he took off running in the opposite direction, going back toward the rear of the lines. And then he came across this officer who was pointing a pistol at him. And the officer said, Private, what do you think you're doing? He said, I'm running. Well, why are you running? I'm afraid. And then he looked at the officer and said, Captain, please give me another chance. And finally, the officer said, I'll give you another chance if you go back to the front. And I need you to take a closer look, and you will see that I'm not a captain. I'm a general. And at that, the private said, I didn't know I'd run that far from the front. Generals aren't usually at the front, you see. Sometimes we tuck tail and run because we are afraid. We've played Satan up and the powers of darkness up so much that we are afraid to take our stand. But we need to take a stand, not just to take a stand, but to win. But to win. But to win. Now, about this armor, that's this forward protection, somebody said, and that might have been Brent Venables, the defensive coordinator for Clemson University, not exactly my favorite school, but God bless you all. That Brent Venables, the defensive coordinator for Clemson, said the best offense, with football season just around the corner, is the best defense. So most of the armor that we're asked to put on is defensive in nature. It's defensive in nature. First of all, we're told to put on the belt of truth. The belt of truth. It's an integral part of the armor. It holds everything together. It holds weapons that are attached to it, like my sword. It holds everything else. It holds the armor together. It encircles the person. And so we should be people of truth, integrity, integral. The belt of truth, so that we mean what we say and we say what we mean, and we don't speak half-truths, but we tell the truth in love, that we're people who have integrity, veracity in who we are. If we are people of truth, then the enemy can't come after us or has no leg to stand on when he does. The devil, Satan, is the father of lies. But what does Jesus say about himself in John chapter 14, verse 6? Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So we come to Jesus, and we wear the belt of truth, and we have integrity. That's the first piece of armor. It holds everything else together. It's foundational. And the second piece of armor is the breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate of righteousness. It covers our throats, our thorax. It covers our heart and our lungs. It covers the vital areas of our inner being. It protects us. The breastplate of righteousness. But whose righteousness is it? Is it our righteousness and our right living and our own strength and our own power? The Bible says that our righteousness is as if it were filthy rags. We can't be righteous in our own strength. Or we could have saved ourselves. No, our righteousness is the imputed righteousness of Christ, that Jesus lived and died a perfect life so that we who have not lived and died a perfect life can be forgiven and we can be set free. So we wear the righteousness of Christ to protect us. It gives us right standing, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, it gives us the ability, a supernatural ability, a not an ability of our own, that we can live a righteous life, and Satan can't attack us then. And then it says we're to wear shoes fitted with the readiness for the gospel of peace. Shoes. Now, whatever shoes you wear to help you accomplish your purpose. If you're playing golf, you need to wear golf shoes so that you can accomplish your purpose. If you're playing baseball or football, you might want to wear cleats so you can get a good grip. If you're a Roman soldier, you need to wear sturdy shoes that can assist you to go swiftly to your destination and accomplish your purpose. Our purpose, it says, is to have shoes fitted with the readiness of the gospel so that our first priority in what we do is to go take the message of Jesus and his love to the world around us. Now, I must admit that some of you are not that good at witnessing. Some of you are too reluctant to do so, and you're better at evangelizing than you think, because a sermon that's seen is always better than one that's heard. So we're to be people who are quick to share the good news that Jesus makes a difference in people's lives. And then the next piece of the garment, a piece of the whole armor of God, is the shield of faith. The shield that a Roman soldier carries can either be round or it can be rectangular, but either way, they have slots around the edges so that you can lock those shields together with the other soldiers beside you so that together you are protected. You can form what's called a phalanx. P-H-A-L-A-N-X. A phalanx where we're shielded together. We're not isolated all alone where the fiery arrows of the evil one come at us and we turn around and show our vulnerable backs and the arrows are pulled out and everybody else is harmed as well. No, we're to stick together. The shield of faith, believing in God, trusting in God that no matter what happens, that God never fails, that Jesus, it says in Hebrews chapter 13, will never leave nor forsake us. That's the foundation of faith and trusting in God. And we build our faith by being in Sunday school, by being in worship, by singing, by being together, by locking our shields together, not being isolated or alone. I heard the story about a fellow who only came to church at Christmas and at Easter. Now, us preacher types, we call those persons Christers. They come just at Christmas and Easter. And this fellow, he had been just coming just at Christmas and at Easter, so the pastor went up to him and asked him, "Are you in the army of the Lord?" He said, "Yes, I am." He said, "Well, why do you only come to church twice a year?" He said, "Would you believe, Pastor? I'm in the Secret Service." No, the shield of faith means that we 24/7, 365 days a year are in the army of the Lord. Our faith is important. It keeps us strong. And then there's the helmet of salvation, and it protects not only the brain, the place of thinking, but it protects my ears. And the reason for that is very often Satan and his minions try to whisper in our ears or get through our helmets and try to avoid it and try to put it in our brains, all these doubts, all these thoughts that are not good. Like, you're not really a Christian. You hope you're a Christian. You think you're a Christian, but you're a hypocrite. And we all know that's true about every one of us, me included. But you know what God wants us to do? He wants us to put on a helmet of salvation. I mean, you're not here by accident today. God wanted you to be here because you need to make sure you have at least got this helmet of faith, this helmet of salvation on, that you know in your mind that you are a Christian. If you believe that Jesus died for your sins and that he rose from the dead in order to prove it, then you're a Christian. If you believe that Jesus died for your sins, took your place on that cross, died for your sins, and if you believe he rose again to prove it, then you're a Christian, no matter what kind of things the enemy tries to put in your mind. So wear the helmet of salvation and wear it with confidence, not confidence in yourself, but confidence in what Jesus has done for you and what Jesus has done for me. And then it says we are to carry the sword of the Spirit, the sword of the Spirit, which it describes as the Word of God. The Roman sword, the Roman short sword, is between 20 inches and 24 inches. It is the only offensive weapon distinctly in this whole list. Everything else is for defense. There's one other after this, but this one is the first offensive weapon. And this sword, the short Roman sword, also called a gladius, it's where we get our word gladiator from. The Roman short sword is to pierce the enemy. It's the Word of God. How well do we know the Scriptures? It says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, that the Scripture divides between soul and spirit, bone and marrow, and it divides even between our motives and our actions. When Satan attacks us, we need to know the Scriptures. You think about Jesus when he was in the wilderness and he was being tempted and tested by the devil. When the devil said all of his temptations, what did Jesus do? Jesus said, "But it is written." But it is written, but it is written. He depended upon the strength of the Word of God. How well do we know Scripture? And where do we learn Scripture? Sunday school classes, disciple Bible studies, church-wide Bible studies. We learn it from one another. We learn it from the preaching and hearing and personal reading of the Holy Bible. And the last piece of equipment, the last part of the full armor of God, it says pray. Pray. All kinds of prayers. Now, a lot of us pray a particular kind of prayer. First of all, we pray for ourselves. Lord, I need this. Lord, I need this. Lord, I need this. And we might pray for our children. We might pray for our friends. But usually it's, Lord, Lord, I need, I need, I need, I need. The best way to explain proper prayer is to use the word acts, A-C-T-S, that our prayer should first of all have adoration, that we praise God at the beginning of our prayers for how great God is. If we remember how great God is and who God is, then our problems become less significant. And then the C of prayer is confession, that we confess to God that we've fallen short of His glory. We've left some things undone that we ought to have done. We do it every day. And we do things every day that we ought not to have done. So we need to spend time in confession and prayer. And then the T of acts is thanksgiving, not just adoring God for who God is, but thanking God for what God has done. And if you go back over in your mind what God has done during a day or during a week, you can remember what God has done, and it builds up your faith. And then the S of Acts stands for supplication. That's when you pray at the very end for God to supply what others need in your life or community and what you yourself need to be supplied to you. So we need to be people of prayer. As a matter of fact, when we're in this spiritual warfare, we need to have prayer warriors. We need people who don't just sing sweet hour prayer, but actually spend an hour in prayer rather than 5 minutes here or 2 minutes there or 15 or 10 at the most all day. We need to be people of prayer. So God wants us to put on the whole armor. You know, it's interesting about clothing. Clothing and armor fulfill two purposes. One of those purposes is functional, and one of those purposes is fashionable. Now, a lot of us think our faith and our Christianity is just the fashionable thing to do. After all, here we are in the Bible Belt. It's fashionable. But let me tell you, for a Roman soldier, for the Apostle Paul, and for every one of us, if we're going to defeat evil and take back our country, take back our city, take back our world for Jesus, then we need to have our armor, our fashions, our clothing as functional, that it fulfills a purpose. Roman soldiers put on their armor primarily to defend themselves, to keep from dying, so they could serve the emperor another day. Christians, no, no. We wear our armor so that we can live. There's a big difference between wearing your armor to keep from dying and wearing your armor to keep living. Because if you wear your armor to keep living, then you're going to want to win the battle. And God wants us to win. So, are you wearing the whole armor? Or are you half-dressed? Or are you fully armored? It's your choice. I don't know what you're missing. It might be the helmet of salvation. You're not sure you're a Christian. It might be the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace and the footwear that you're wearing, and you're not as ready to go out and tell people about Jesus. You might be missing the integrity of the belt of truth. You might be missing the breastplate of righteousness. You don't have right living because Jesus' righteousness is not living in you. You might be missing the shield of faith, and you're not joining together with other Christians. You might not be praying enough. You might not know the word enough. What is it that you need? Put it on. Put it all on, and we will win the battle. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. One of my favorite hymns, we don't sing it near enough, but I hope you'll sing it and mean it. It is the hymn, Onward Christian Soldiers. May we stand as you're able.
Thank you.
Even in the midst of battle, may the peace of God that passes all understanding guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus our Lord. May the living power and presence of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and abide with you now and forevermore. Amen.